before we dive into the nitty-gritty here, like any good squad of philosophers would do, because we're all philosophers now, right? We've decided that we're philosophizing for a living. We do have to define some terms. That's what all good philosophers do. Before we talk about anything, we've got to define some terms here. And many of you probably already understand, you know, what I'm talking about here. And, you know, that's fine. Like, you're going to accuse me of thinking you're an idiot, and that's okay. I don't think you're an idiot. But if I'm being honest with myself, I would know that, you know, there's a lot of things in this world that, you know, in my past life of being the good boy, liberal, innocent, there's a lot of things that I didn't understand, but was too embarrassed to admit, right? And the difference now is that I'm happy to admit when I don't know something, because if I don't, I'm not going to learn anything. This is the like mentality that med students have when they're like too afraid to ask questions because they don't want to sound like a fucking bumbling fool. This is like example number one is me. I learned that way too late. And I started asking questions in residency when it was like, yeah, probably a little bit too late. I was like behind on a lot of basic shit because I just didn't want to sound dumb. And it's okay when you don't know something. All right. And I'm not saying you don't know anything. I'm saying as a general fact, you don't know something, it's okay. We're all here to learn. Life is an ongoing learning process. So let's jump in here. We're going to define some terms so we can all be on the same page. We're going to build our meta structure for understanding all these things from the simple to the complex. And what we're going to talk about first, when we're talking about the economy, is ownership. We're going to talk about public versus private. Okay, this is like the first bullet point here. The first question we should ask when we're thinking about the economy is who owns things, right? Again, we're not talking about stonks. We're not talking about the stock market. We're talking about who owns things, okay? Ownership generally broken into two groups, okay, for simplicity, the public sector and the private sector. When we're talking about the public sector, we're talking about entities that are owned and operated by national governments. Okay, this is like public services, public school, public roads, bridges, electrical grids, the fire department, police and military, all these kinds of things. So they provide services like education and infrastructure and ostensibly public safety when it comes to law enforcement. But that can be debated, I think, because the police are enforcers of state repression and hold a monopoly on violence. But that's a discussion for another day. In addition to public services, the public sector is also composed of state-owned or public enterprises, things you've heard of, Amtrak, the... goddamn, don't you wish Amtrak were just this robust... oh my God, if I could just take a train to the next city over rather than wait at the airport for fucking 4 hours and be, you know, felt up in the security line and packed in there like a goddamn sardine and have my whole, maybe it's ableist for me to talk about flying on an airplane here. I'm just going to throw that out there, but it is one of the most dehumanizing experiences to be packed in there on an airplane and, you know, have to share a row with somebody whose feet kind of smell. I'm talking personal experience here. And maybe one day I'll tell you all the story about how I peed my pants on a plane as a youngin. That's maybe for another day.
Okay. That's for the premium episode.
That's when for we the get Patreon. Patreon going. Yep. Sign up. Patreon.com/. That's for the Patreon. So things like Amtrak, USPS, AmeriCorps, the FDIC, these are all state-owned enterprises, okay? What differentiates the public sector here? It's something that doesn't really have interest in making a profit, right? Like, think about public school. Are they trying to, like, make money off of people? Like, not really. Some of the state-owned companies can and do function in a more commercially-oriented mindset. I think Sigmund pointed out something important here. The USPS, you would imagine that this would be a public service, but... What is it since like the 1970s they've been like forced to make a profit?
Yeah, so that's like the one of the only government services that relies, I think, almost entirely from its own revenue and sales. And they've been hamstrung by legislation that says they have to be able to pay for 75 years of retirement. which is a requirement that no other government agency really has.
No.
And guess where USPS is? All over the country, including some very, very prime real estate in centers of cities. I stand USPS. They will deliver to every single address in this country, even the ones where FedEx and UPS won't.
Let's not forget that that charge that they needed to be profitable in order to fund like that specific amount for their retirement came under the Bush administration, because of course the neoconservatives under there were trying to privatize it. And the Obama administration could have easily fought back against that, and they didn't, because they wanted to continue that project. It is why Louis DeJoy is still the postmaster general under Joseph R. Biden.
Yeah. Where's the criticism here? Oh God, they're trying to sabotage the USPS and da, da, da. Like, oh, well, he's still there. Okay. Yep. He's serving the empire. He wasn't serving Donald Trump. He's serving the empire, right? This is a bipartisan effort here when it comes to stuff like that. We still stand the USPS. Shout out. If you live in a rural area, there's honestly like no other way sometimes that you'll get, you know, medications delivered to you, very important things that people need, because hey, FedEx, like, yeah, we're not coming out there. Or it's like, hey, it's $60 to come to your place, you know, out in the holler. That's real, you know? So USPS is literally helping people in terms of survival. So shout out USPS. Why do public entities not really care about profit? Well, whether people realize this or not, the federal government is the only issuer of our fiat currency, which is known as the US dollar. Maybe people don't know this either. We haven't been on the gold standard in 50 years, people.
Thank you, Nixon.
Really? I mean, I think it was like 1971, 72. We have not been on the gold standard in literally half a century. And people still think it's a thing, I guess. What does this mean? It means we cannot run out of money. If we can print the money, we got the damn money. We got the money bags, okay? The United States federal government is the monopoly, man. They're holding up fucking money bags.
Yeah, money printer go burr.
Money printer go burr, exactly. We're out the Federal Reserve. We're fucking made of money. So we can't run out of it. So why would you prioritize profit? It's like kind of meaningless. Why do they need your money? Why does the government need your money? They can always print more, right? As long as you know, take measures to prevent inflation. If you're interested in reading more, you can look up Stephanie Kelton, MMT, Modern Monetary Theory, which may make me sound like a revisionist, but I think it's something that leftists and Marxists should kind of take seriously, because it's more and more coming into the public eye. Now, contrast to the public sector. The private sector refers to these commercial enterprises that are owned and operated by private interests who own land, capital, and means of production and intend to profit from it. That's important. And again, I think Sigmund made a good point in that whenever communists, people bring this up, they're like, they invariably are charged with, you know, wanting to take your toothbrush or like your personal possessions.
iPhone. I am going to personally come and beat you up and take your iPhone. The revolution.
Yeah. Sorry. You don't get to own your little trinkets anymore. All of your Beanie Babies that you've been saving up and waiting for that to hit. That's under communist overlord's possession now.
We're shutting down eBay.
Our Beanie Baby economy, no.
Yeah, we're tanking the Beanie Baby economy. We're getting rid of the Let Go app. We're getting rid of Craigslist. Everything is owned by the Supreme Chancellor. No. Well, there's a difference here between personal property and private property, right? When we're talking about private property, which is what really capitalism is predicated on. We're talking about private ownership of means of production, things that are able to generate profit, right? Through labor. That's private property. Personal property is all that other shit we're talking about. We're not going to take your glasses, okay? We're not going to take your shaver or your toothbrush. You get to keep that stuff. That's yours. That's personal property. So very big distinction there. Don't let PragerU fucking losers tell you that the communists are coming for your shit, okay? They're not. So these private sector ghouls, what are they, what can this mean, right? A lot of different things. They can be sole proprietorships, you know, single owner companies, mom and pop shops, small businesses. And we're talking about medicine here, private practice doctors. These are private sector entities, right? They are docs who are out there. They own their own practice. They own all of their means of production and they employ people. We would maybe refer to these people as petite bourgeois. And we can talk about what that means maybe some other time. What else can the private sector mean? It can mean people who form cooperatives, meaning people who both own and work at the business simultaneously. If it's, you know, predicated on a one person, one vote structure. Co-ops are cool, but they're not like the silver bullet. There's a million different kinds of co-ops out of the topic, out of the scope of this discussion, but maybe something you should look into because they're pretty interesting. The big bad one that we all know, dun, 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 are the corporations, meaning a group of people that have incorporated into a single entity that is legally recognized as a person. What the fuck? But that's true. That's law in the United States. A corporation is a person. And let me tell you, corporations have more rights than you do, right? If the current state of things don't tell you anything, you at least know that corporations have more rights than you do as individuals. It's fucking disgusting, but you know, whatever. This, we should come to expect it at this point. And you know, if you want to know more about that, I recommend you watch The Corporation. It's a documentary from 2003. It's pretty good. Anyways. Usually corporations are owned by, you know, multiple investors and shareholders. They have fiduciary responsibilities to those shareholders, which means the CEO, the only thing they care about is making money for these people, for the shareholders. And who makes the decisions in these corporations? Well, it's an unelected board of directors. And I'm going to underline unelected because, you know, we live in a democracy, don't we? Not really. The workplace is about as undemocratic as it gets for most people because you are under a servile labor contract to an unelected group of people who you never see or interact with, and you probably don't even know what they look like, right? Very democratic, right? These unelected board of directors, they hire administrators. We love administrators, folks. Managers, the tyrants of the workplace. And they oversee, what do? They oversee workers. Well, who are the workers? Us. There's this hierarchy that exists of the unelected board of directors who hire the people who tell us what to do, right? And all we can do is sell our labor, once again, sell our ability to work, and all we get is a wage. The common thread that ties all these things together is that nearly all the activities of the private enterprise are motivated by profit. Returning investment to shareholders. But what about the stakeholders, you might ask? All the other people who are affected by the decisions the company makes, but have no say in this process of decision-making. That's what we're saying. Well, shit, what about us? What the fuck? We just got to like wait for them to make a decision. And then we're like, oh, I don't like that, but we can't do anything. That sucks. What can we do? Yeah, that's what we're saying. We shouldn't let these people make all the decisions. So, you know, you might be asking now, all right, I get it. You're making some points here. Well, I thought we were talking about healthcare here. Who runs healthcare, right? Public sector, private sector. The not very satisfying answer is both. And we're going to come back to this a little bit later. But first, we have to talk about the other aspects of the economy, the production and the distribution of resources. So we just talked about ownership. Now we're talking about how we produce things and how we distribute those resources. And I'm not going to spend a lot of time on this because it's really, I don't want to venture down this path for an extended period, but I will say that economists want you to believe that economics is a hard science. It's not, okay? It's a mechanism through which society is organized. It's created by people. And therefore, what does that mean? It can be changed or dismantled by people. Is this the same thing as, let's say, like chemistry or physics? No, it's an actual hard science. It has laws that you can't change. They just are, okay? There are no inherent principles or laws to economics in and of itself. There is just observations, there's relationships, but they depend on situations and preconditions created by subjective agents, right? So not a hard science. Don't let people lie to you. Economics as a hard science was created by academics who wanted to prop up this fake industry, really, to make their friends and themselves more money, which, again, kind of makes sense under this system. So in broad strokes here, a market economy versus a planned economy, right? This is the, these are the kind of ways to think about how we produce and distribute resources. So what is a market economy? That's what we have. It's a way of organizing society where we produce and distribute resources in a way where buyers and sellers meet to exchange things that each of them want, right? One entity sells some commodity to a buyer, usually in exchange for money, which we said earlier was the universal equivalent of exchange, just an easy way to exchange things. And the money prices of those commodities reflect this interplay of the supply of commodities by producers and the demand of commodities by consumers. So markets are a place people meet and buy, sell goods and services. The prices fluctuate depending on how much of that thing exists and how much people want that thing. And there are other things that affect those costs, of course. It's not, don't listen to people who just say it's supply and demand. It's a lot more than that. Obviously, it's labor costs, costs of raw materials, blah, 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 but we're keeping it simple. What is the flip side of market economy? Well, you've probably heard this term, the planned economy. The evil communists used to do this in evil Soviet Russia. But if you think about it, a planned economy kind of makes sense in a lot of ways, right? How do we produce and distribute resources? By a plan. Do you just like go into work and just do shit randomly, or do you plan stuff out, right? Do you plan your day? Do you plan your weekend? Do you plan important things, or do you just like hope it works out, right? I hope you plan things that are meaningful and important, right?
Well, and it especially makes sense for like things where typically outside of like horrible global pandemic years, like we know kind of how many visits or how many patients we have in a hospital, and things like healthcare are going to, like, it's going to be something that you need no matter what. It's not like a luxury product. Like I can wait to buy a fancy bag or a fancy car, but I can't really wait if I break my arm, right? Yes. Like these, I can't wait for the prices to get better. I can't really shop around. There's like a lot of ways in which like there isn't really a choice as a consumer. It doesn't really make sense to think of it that way. And we can usually plan on like the greater scale, like how much healthcare or housing like people are going to need in a given year based on like lots of data that we collect.
Let's not forget, like the key word here is a democratically planned economy.
Yes. When people hear of planned economy, they think of, it's only this like centralized bureaucratic, like, you know, it doesn't, again, it doesn't have to be that way. We can talk about historical examples. Like I said, the Soviet Union was one example of a planned economy. And, you know, unfortunately, I'm playing sad violin music, which I'll add later, fell in 1991, the year I was born, which if you think about it, makes a lot of sense.
Pizza Hut. Goddamn Pizza Hut. Jesus Christ.
I think the Soviet Union fell so that I could be born in a way. A phoenix, yeah. Reborn from the ashes.
The spirit just like flew into you and then you were born.
That's exactly right. And people tell me I look a lot like Stalin, so that makes even more sense. No, I'm just kidding. I wish. Fuck.
So young hot. Stalin. Don't sleep on him.
Google a picture of young Stalin right now, okay? It's going to change your mind about the Soviet Union. Just that picture, okay? What else? The People's Republic of China from about 1949 up until the end of the Maoist period in the late 70s. These are kind of what people think of when we talk about a centralized planned economy. But what about a decentralized planned economy? Oh my God, is that real? Is that a thing? Well, what does that even mean? It's a coordinated network of economic agents that are separate, right? And has this ever existed before? Yes, it has, and it actually still does. We're talking about areas like Catalonia, who are heavily influenced by the revolutionary anarcho-syndicalist trade unions during the time of the Spanish Civil War. This is in the 1930s. Elements of these decentralized planning mechanisms, they still exist today in some of these autonomous regions of Spain. I suggest you check that out as well. These things do exist. They're not just pie in the sky, oh, leftist unicorns and rainbows. They all just, you know, they just hope for better things and they're dreamers. No, these things actually do exist and they work pretty well. Markets, though, yes, they've existed for a long time. This is something that apologists for capitalism bring up all the time when they try to argue that capitalism is some like manifestation of human nature, which is like patently fucking false. If you bother to, you know, read sociology, anthropology, history, markets only became institutionalized very recently, right? They only existed sporadically in the past in human history. There's all kinds of ways we've produced things and distributed resources in the past, things like reciprocity, redistribution. We still do redistribution in some sense, not as much as we used to. But only in the last 200 years, really, has market economy really taken form as a world system, right? The dominating economic logic of society at large. Before, they were intermittent, sporadic spheres of exchange. Now it is a world system. What's the problem then with market economy? Oh boy, loaded question. Well, a big issue is that, what do we hear about market economy, right? It's this, you know, boosts productivity and innovation. Oh God, and inefficiency, you know, except it doesn't really do that. Like when it comes to making things and getting them to people who want or need them, prices, the central aspect of markets, right, which fluctuate depending on supply and demand of things and other things, prices have a huge impact on who has access to what things. And that's because this relationship between income and prices of commodities, I mean, think about this, okay? It's very simple. If you have a low income, you're probably not going to be able to afford certain prices, right? You're not going to be able to afford certain things. So the way that markets prioritize resource distribution is not based on need, which would make sense when we're talking about, let's say, healthcare or food or housing. Markets distribute or prioritize resource distribution based on the ability to pay. Okay. That is how that is the market logic. If you can pay for something, you have access to it. If you need something, you better hope you have enough money for it. And when we're talking about, you know, an economic mode of production like capitalism, obviously this is causing major problems. We already talked about income inequality, right? It's a defining feature of our age. And it's going to become even more crystal clear when we talk about healthcare finance. You know, pretty self-evident, the way we do healthcare in the United States, the way we produce and distribute things is on a marketized basis in healthcare. Let's talk about health insurance just for a quick second. Let's concretize the abstract. We'll leave healthcare administration to the side for now. So health insurance companies and consumers, and again, we're talking about patients here. These are consumers of healthcare, customers. They meet at the healthcare, at the health insurance market. You know, just imagine you're out, it's a sunny day, you have your little wicker basket, and you're shopping for health insurance. Right? Your mother sent you out to gather some health insurance for the family and bring them home post haste. Well, insurance companies can sell that healthcare coverage to patients in exchange for money in many forms, premiums, copays. We'll talk about this more a little bit later. On the surface, this kind of makes sense. Everybody wins, right? I get health insurance, they get my money. But this kind of ties back to what we were saying about ownership. Insurance companies are private sector entities that want to profit, while patients are people who want healthcare. They want comprehensive and affordable insurance coverage. I mean, that's a consistent feature with any commercially oriented enterprise, right? Companies want to make money. Consumers want the best product or service for the lowest price. That's, you know, this is a given pretty much for a market economy. But the problem is just that, right? Healthcare is run as a business. Healthcare in the United States is a commodity. right? It's bought or sold. It's not guaranteed as a human right. Insurance companies are not interested in providing you with like a great product, right? They're interested in taking your money. That's all they want. They want to take as much of your money as possible because of what Sigmund said before. This system is predicated on the most profit possible, not because necessarily they are bad people, because if they don't, they will get outcompeted and they will die, right? The logic of the system itself necessitates profit prioritization, even at the expense of human suffering, right? This is one of like the primary contradictions of capitalism, that consumers want a great product for a low price, but people who sell shit want to raise the price as much as possible and lower costs. It doesn't really add up. Think about all the big corporations and monopolies that have a huge influence on society, not just healthcare. We've all had personal experiences with companies selling us cheap bullshit that doesn't work. They mark up the price. They just want to profit, right? Again, the issue is that we're talking about health insurance companies. When they skimp on their product and mark up the price, people suffer. People die, okay? They either can't afford to buy it, health insurance, or they can't afford to use it, right? They can buy it, but they can't use it, which is functionally the same thing, right? So when we're talking about people who are uninsured and underinsured, pretty much functionally the same thing. It dissuades people from seeking healthcare when they really need it, or even just like for primary care, like routine surveillance, right? And if they do use their health insurance, they go into massive debt after interacting with the healthcare system, because talking about out-of-pocket costs, insurers deciding they just don't want to pay for something. Actually, no, we're not going to pay for your MRI. So that's, you know, that's $1,200. Sorry about that. We just don't want to pay for it. And you know, obviously,
if we're going to get into, I don't know how much we'll get into like the ACA later, but I mean, that cost, like, I know people, a lot of liberals, like, think of the ACA as this like amazing thing, Obamacare. But I think it's like really hard to like overstress that that was just a huge a boon to the private insurance industry. That was, yes, it. Like it increased insurance coverage, but like at the same rates, it increased the number of people who were underinsured and couldn't afford to use their plans. And even though like the increase in the healthcare premiums for the employer-based plans slowed down, there was a huge increase in the out-of-pocket cost for the patients, because now you have like a captive population who like have to buy insurance, right? Mm-hmm. At least until they got rid of the individual mandate, I guess. And like, that's why the equivocated, or like calling health insurance an equivalent to actually receiving the end product, which is healthcare, like that makes just zero sense. You're just adding in so many middlemen who are just profiting off of your insurance premiums and co-pays and co-insurances and all this other bullshit that I don't want to know about.
You have to understand that there is a moral way to look at it, like to understand like people are envisioning the ACA's growth as an extension of a moral necessity in a society to provide healthcare. And we confuse that, because what the ACA did was just grow the entire industry. And one of the side effects was that more people are receiving care, but they are receiving care through a consumptive basis. They are now consumers. And if we think about it like that, we should be very honest and understand how strong the class connection is. The only way you receive care in this society is if you are employed and more than likely have employer-based insurance, or able to afford care through the marketplace, which the marketplace itself is shit, with the coverage gaps and everything else, like all the inadequacies that came of it, right? Underinsurance, that's the big one. The really shitty plans that you see that have proliferated since like 2014, as Obama was, you know, coming out of office, and people like Aetna and like Cigna were trying to fuck around and essentially pull a capitalist straw man tactics, which is why they pulled themselves out of the marketplace. But if we think broadly, and if we hold that moral view in immediate focus, that says that there is a class of citizens that are unworthy of care.
Yes.
They just simply don't deserve it. That is literally what the system is built on, what it is describing to you without ever saying. So it is a capitalist carrot for you to be healthy and work. And that's why we also sit here and say things like in our current like situation, why like, well, if you're disabled, well, we have Medicare and Medicaid.
Oh boy.
Bigger conversations for another day. But instead of fundamentally understanding as healthcare being a right afforded to everyone, that you are more than the value of your labor and what you produce, that you are worthy of anything that is good in this world simply because you exist, like we talk about housing, food, education, healthcare, then we need to understand, as we were talking about earlier in this episode, how the very connection to capitalist-based healthcare is connected to class and is connected to identity.
Absolutely. And we're going to get into the intricacies of healthcare finance in a later episode. This is kind of just a broad scope view of our discussions that are going to come in the future. We're going to talk about all those kind of more detailed things. We just don't have time for it in this episode, right? So all of these things that Bay and Sigmund are talking about, as you can imagine, tremendous financial implications, social, psychological implications, right? People are equating, trying to find healthcare on the marketplace with, like, think about this. It's not the same, okay, as when someone can't afford to buy a pair of Yeezys, right? Okay, that's not a human need, right? I mean, you could say clothing is a human need for, like a safe environment, keep yourself warm and all that shit. But Yeezys in themselves, not a human need. So when someone can't afford a pair of Yeezys, but they can still show up to the function in a clean pair of Nike Monarchs, okay? That's not the same as not being able to afford health insurance, okay? Why? I mean, healthcare as a commodity is the difference between life and death for so many people, okay? We said we would come back to this question of who runs healthcare, the public sector or the private sector. Unfortunately, this is not even the right question to ask. I pulled an oopsie on you once again. The question to ask, all right, who administers healthcare and who finances healthcare? We've alluded to this a couple of times, but this is the question. This is how our meta structure evolves from this simple question. Who provides and administers healthcare? Who finances it? Who sells healthcare and who pays for healthcare? It's really as simple as that. When we're talking about conceptualizing and breaking down the medical industrial complex. So we'll talk briefly about healthcare administration, right? And it's not really briefly. We have a little bit to go through here. But when we're talking about healthcare admin, what we're really asking is who actually carries out the process of delivering medical care to people who need it, okay? Obviously, many links in this vast chain of interactions, and I'm going to miss a couple things, but I got to simplify to get through this, okay? We'll compare this complex within healthcare and medicine to something kind of everybody understands, right? Everybody's been going out to eat, right? Maybe not since COVID. I mean, some of you maybe, but everybody's gone out to eat at least once, right? So we're gonna put these two things in parallel, right? Let's start with the very small, okay? Things on the individual level. This is who makes the sausage, right? Who makes the sausage in healthcare? We're talking about bedside nurses, physicians, dentists, pharmacists, advanced practice providers, NPs and PAs and these types, students, volunteers, all of the therapists, physical, occupational, all these dietitians, audiologists, social work, all the technologists, all of these other workers as well who don't directly contribute to administering healthcare but are critical to the function. We're talking about cafeteria workers, we're talking about support staff, environmental services, porters, all of these workers that are necessary for any healthcare setting to actually function. right? And when we're talking about, again, food service workers, right? We're talking about, these are the equivalent of the prep cooks, the line cooks, bussers, dishwashers, bartenders, these, all of these kinds of workers, right? That's who makes the sausage. When we zoom out a little bit, we can kind of abstractly identify the factories or the workshops of healthcare, right? This is where the sausage gets made. We're talking about outpatient clinics, hospitals, surgery centers, pharmacies, rehab centers, SNFs, LTACs, laboratories, imaging centers, all these kinds of places, right? This is where healthcare is administered. And all these are akin to, yeah, the places you go out to eat for food or drinks, restaurants, fast casual spots, coffee shops, all this. So then we go out even further and we pinpoint the concrete structures, right? We went from individuals, who makes the sausage, to where the sausage gets made. Now we're talking about structures here, okay? This is who holds the marionette strings. These are the actors that are the large entities that provide labor, capital, knowledge, and influence, right? And we're going to talk about how all these institutions kind of interact. We're talking about healthcare delivery, politics, all this stuff. We'll talk about that in depth a little bit later, but for now, we're just naming who these actors are, right? Billing providers, right? Physicians, APPs, therapists, the people who are in private practice or group practice, the employed, the 1099, the locums, all the people who are billing for services, right? Hospital systems, including the private for-profits, the voluntary nonprofits, the local public hospitals, all of these hospital systems. Who else administers healthcare? The pharmaceutical and the biotechnology industries, right? We're talking about, I like to break this down into three categories, okay? The drug manufacturers, the drug wholesalers, and the drug retailers is a nice way to think about this industry. So you've heard all these names before. The main drug manufacturers, Pfizer, you know, Merck, Mylan, Novo Nordisk, Gilead, like all these kinds of companies. The drug wholesalers, Cardinal Health, AmerisourceBergen, McKesson, these are the drug wholesalers. And then the drug retailers is basically pharmacies, right? CVS, Walgreens, Walmart is one of the biggest pharmacies in the United States, which people don't realize. Kroger, which, you know, shout out, I miss being a bagger there sometimes, simpler times.
I used to get $1 succulents there and I miss my Kroger.
Oh, cute. I miss cleaning the bathrooms. that was a good time. I miss bringing all the carts in like the 90 degree heat. And then the manager coming up to me and being like, you can't listen to music while you're doing that. I'm like, oh, so you just want me to kill myself. Cool. That's no problem. Like the only thing that's like allowing me to just get through this shit.
And years later, we are naming and shaming because cancel culture is coming.
Naming and shaming. Exactly. I knew this would pay off one day.
You're fucking canceled, Kroger. God damn it.
We got the crosshair set on you. Okay. I want to listen to Flowbots when I'm bringing the fucking carts back inside. Okay. God damn you. Oh, it feels good to have power now on a podcast. Anyways. Who else? The pharmacy benefit managers. I cannot wait to dive into this when we talk about our full episode on healthcare administration. These are like the fucking secret police of the medical industrial complex. These are entities that most people have never heard of. Express Scripts, OptumRx, they are like existing in the shadows, but they are pulling so many strings. And are like the true middleman of healthcare administration. They're like insurance companies, but on the healthcare administration side. And we're, you know, again, we'll talk about this in full detail in another episode. By the way, CVS, known as CVS Caremark, is now not only a drug retailer, but also part of the pharmacy benefit management side of things. Gotta love that. Who else? The medical technology and device makers, Medtronic, Philips, Stryker, B. Braun, Siemens, all of these giant companies that make all of the stuff that you see, the echo machines, the syringes, the needles, all of the like you know, fancy OR gadgets and shit. This is a massive industry that I don't think gets talked about enough, but is very important. And kind of the flip side of that is the medical equipment companies, but there's some overlap there. Things like Medline, GE, Invacare, Sunrise Medical, these companies really participate. But there's, like I said, some overlap with the device makers as well. Academia, right? Medical research milieu, medical schools, the NIH, university medical centers, the IRB, contract research organizations like LabCorp, Syneos. There are some kind of, again, we'll talk about all these things in detail in a later episode. The licensing authorities, we love these. The FSMB, the National Board of Medical Examiners, these are the entities that own the USMLE program, right? The accreditation bodies, the LCME, the ACGME, and everybody's favorite, the fucking Joint Commission. Oh, man. Ooh. Everybody loves JCO, right? How many times a year do I get, hey, you can't bring your jacket into the OR. JCO's here. Like, you know, like...
Yeah, you can't be drinking at your workstation.
Yeah. Stop drinking at the nurse's station.
Yeah.
Stop breathing loudly. JCO's here.
Stop doing the bare minimum to get through the shit that is your job in healthcare.
I remember all the emails we'd get like during like JCO visit week or whatever, and they'd be like, do not talk to anybody, just refer them to us. Don't answer any questions.
Yeah. Be silent. Don't, you might slip up. Just shut up.
Yeah. Like just in case you said like, oh yeah, I'm allowed to be here. No.
I mean, JCO strikes fear in the hearts of millions, and it shouldn't be that way.
Like after COVID, they definitely have to be canceled, right? Like they were just letting people walk around in garbage bags.
Yeah. I mean, but that's the thing. Like JCO, when they show up, it's a different hospital, right? Altogether. Everybody's like on their fucking A game. They're on their best behavior when JCO's there. And then they leave and everybody's like, all right, back to the bullshit now. Do whatever the fuck you want. JCO's gone. It's kind of weird how that works, but JCO is a little too powerful. We'll talk about them. We're almost through here. Patient advocacy groups, the American Cancer Society, the American Heart Association, the National Alliance on Mental Illness. They seem like these very important and these groups that are really doing great work, and you know they are in some instances, but you'd be surprised how you know what actually goes on in the background with some of these advocacy groups.
We're coming for you, nonprofit sector.
That's right. And then there's the political actors, the AMA, which we absolutely love. They're the sweetest bitch you'll ever meet. The AMA. The APA, the AHA, you gotta love these. CIR, SEIU, the various nursing unions, all of the lobbyists that work on behalf of all of these previously mentioned entities. These are all political actors, right? So how does this compare with our food and drink comparison? These are the farmers, the seed manufacturers. I'm talking about Monsanto, the livestock and the meatpacking industry, companies like Tyson, the farms themselves, right? Whether they're individual small farms or factory farms like Cargill, agro and petrochemical companies like Dow DuPont, food storage facilities, processing plants like Nestle, and then there's the large scale food distributors like US Foods, right? Every one of these needs, there exists a complex that administers this for profit in very disgusting ways with negative externalities that, guess what, they fuck over people like you and me. So obviously all these healthcare actors have some things in common. They have some competing interests. Some just want to take care of patients and make a decent living. Others want to cut corners and boost productivity and efficiency at the expense of working conditions. Some want to upcode or make up codes that don't exist. Some want to, you know, carry guns in their pathology office just in case. That's a throwback. And some just want to rule the world, right? A la Tears for Fears. But the point to take home is that all these entities, with some crossover, mostly compose the sector of healthcare dealing with actually providing and administering medical care, whether directly or indirectly. And overwhelmingly, where does healthcare administration fall? Well, it's under the umbrella of the private sector, which once again is predicated on profit generation. There are a few exceptions. We're talking about some, you know, entities within the voluntary sector, like some nonprofits, but guess what? Many nonprofits are actually very much interested in turning a profit. The public sector has some exceptions, some county hospitals, the VA, which is a federal government institution, U.S. Public Health Service. It means that these extremely important aspects of healthcare are under the purview of market economy and for-profit entities. What could go wrong? You know, a human need being administered for profit, right? Should work out. I don't see any issues. And this kind of ties back into our previous episodes, right? The closure of safety net hospitals that, yeah, become luxury condos or just like real estate, speculative assets in general. Not non-profitable psychiatric hospitals that close. They just don't make money, so they might as well not exist, right? Better off.
Which is all psych hospitals, really. Yeah. So like every psych hospital is at risk of closure.
Yeah. Well, you might be at the point where you're like, all right, maybe they're right. Maybe Eminem's right. This is all kind of fucked up. Maybe healthcare shouldn't be run using for-profit logic, but what do we do? Okay. What is to be done? A famous person said that once. Well, we're going to expound on this in future episodes. Like we said, this is a recurring series and we hope you join us for the next few. Hope we didn't scare you off with some light philosophical, economic, and sociological study. But what is to be done is many, many things. There is no silver bullet, unfortunately, for solving healthcare. Briefly, from the perspective of the buyers of healthcare, right? The primary objective is to abolish the private payer known as health insurance companies, the middleman, the parasites. And not just that, also the current public payers. We're talking about Center for Medicare and Medicaid Services, CHIP. And you're like, oh, why would you want to get rid of that? Well, what would be better? How about a national, publicly owned, universal, federal, single payer?
Ooh.
What if we did that?
Goddamn.
What if we called it Medicare for All? What if we did that instead?
Damn. You could run a campaign off that. Just that thing.
Are you winning, son?
Damn. You put a bird on it. Yeah, folks, we need that. We need a monopsony, okay? And we'll talk about what that means in a future episode. But we need a universal federal single payer. That's another thing we can chant together. Let's do it on three. One, two, three. A universal federal single payer. A universal federal single. I got a chill running down my spine just saying it.
I got something
else. I feel like that should be maybe what we compromise to.
Mm-hmm. Yes, the other half of that. Very important here. You thought I was done, didn't you?
Yeah.
You think we're fucking fools on Eminem, didn't you? Oh, fucking liberals. They just want Medicare for all. Yeah. Guess what? What about the people that sell healthcare? What about those that provide and administer healthcare? Well, just imagine me with the laser eyes meme. It starts with nationalizing all of these fucking entities that I said, the pharmaceutical, medical device industry, the hospitals, the pharmacies, the abolishing the pharmacy benefit managers, revamping the entire medical education curriculum, reimagining academia and university hospitals. All of this needs to be dismantled and started over. I mean, it's not just the payer. It's not just Medicare for all. We need that, okay? But that's not it. There's so much more that we need to do. And the reason that nationalization is so important is because this entire interpolating industry has to be brought under public control. The reason for that, we have to create this environment where profit is not the motive in providing healthcare. The profit motive is what is killing people, okay? The fact that people will do anything to outcompete those in the marketplace, right? The beloved marketplace, even if that means you can't afford your insulin, even if that means you can't afford to use your insurance, even if that means you have medical debt now, they got theirs. Fuck you. That is this economic system, right? We said it in the beginning. Transactional relationships. What do I get out of this? This is the world we live under. And if we don't take these steps, we're headed down a rough path. I don't really see how healthcare is sustainable. And guess what? It's not. That's what the ACA did, right? That's what we were talking about before. It's a way of propping up the current system. Yeah, maybe some more people got some healthcare coverage out of it, but it also perpetuates an exploitative, coercive health insurance industry. So I think might be a good place for me to stop. I'm really sorry. I mansplained for a long time this episode. I was kind of hoping y'all would interrupt me a little bit more.
Oh, no, King. Like, King, this was your episode. Off. Like, this was yours. We knew it from the get-go. This was your moment to shine. And boy, did you.
Y'all, I put a lot of work into this, okay?
Yeah. You did.
If y'all understood, for those listening, if y'all understood the amount of work that had gone into just this episode to give you a definitionary primer and a basis for where we are going to go in these next future episodes, you would give this man a kiss on the cheek.
And I'm vaccinated, so.
Yeah.
So you should. When you see Fidel out in the street, just give him a nice big kiss.
Yeah, baby. I'm, you know, again, sorry, my girlfriend, if you're listening, this is parody, of course, always parody. I feel good. I feel like I'm accepting an Emmy or something right now. I just want to thank all my homies who say fuck healthcare. I want to thank all the memes that I've seen in my life that have led me to this spot. Here's the secret. Memes are an incredibly revolutionary mechanism of radicalizing people. It worked on me, at least. I mean, in addition to other things, but you know. And then I'd like to thank... I'm not going to thank the Academy because, you know, that's part of the problem, of course. And I'd like to thank my co-hosts here who support me. They blow me kisses through the Zoom camera and they snap in a very poetry session-like manner. So thank you all. I couldn't have done it without you. And we couldn't have done it without each other. And that's the world we're trying to create, right? Last thoughts from either of you, things you'd like to add at the end?
No, that's such a wholesome place to end it.
I know, like, I really don't want to ruin this moment.
I know, I'm about to go hug my pillow and just smile for a couple hours.
I would say that for listeners, we are moving into a more concrete direction with Nuance for y'all.
Yes.
And at the same time saying that, please understand that there is no minutia that will serve as a panacea to the system that we are describing and the system that you are working in. What we need, to just be bold and frank, should be understood and termed as class warfare. There is nothing more important than building a mass movement of workers to achieve the society that we want. Nothing short. All right. No monetary theory. No specific way of looking at things within a theoretical lens, organizing day to day and building comrade-like-ship with the people you could like work with.
Deadass. Well said, my friend. I hope you join us along for this journey. There's a couple episodes that we're going to focus in on healthcare finance. We're going to focus in on healthcare administration. And because we are not postmodernists, we're not going to stop there. We are going to offer a concrete, what do we do, right? After deconstruction must come reconstruction, okay? It's pretty easy to say how bad everything is. like I said, we're all getting the sense that this world is in some way fucked up, disgusting, blah, blah, blah. We all know that. It's the, well, what do we do about it? That's important. And if you stick with us over the next couple episodes of this series, and they're not going to be back to back, I think we're going to intersperse them throughout. And I don't know what our next episode would be, but I hope you join us for our next episode and the ones to follow. I think this is a good place to leave it. We love you. We're supportive of all of your endeavors, unless they're against class warfare. And we'll see you next time.